Foster Car Finance, proud sponsors of the How Are We Farmerland podcast. Haha, it's right, lad.
Hello and welcome back to the How Are We Farmerland podcast. How are we,
Farmerland? How are we, Farmerland?
Look who we've got in.
The main man.
Darren Till.
The main guy.
How are we, Farmerland?
Just do it for me, John.
How are we? A little surprise for you later.
Have you got a surprise? Yeah,
got a good yeah with this. No, I'll do it in a bit. Come on. Yeah.
You're doing it in front of me. What are you
going to
do?
No, you messed that. He's having a fucking fat. you might nip off later to the toilet and you might come back as someone else. Okay. Anyway, Darren, welcome.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to finally have you here.
Sweet.
I've never met you in real life. Well, you're having in the barbers. You used to cut your hair years ago.
It was Bawley's at the bottom of our street in Delamore.
Mm.
And you'd open just after Bawley. This was years ago, though. 28 now, so.
Yeah. I know you did. You come in the coffee shop. Yeah. It was like, all right, mate.
Yeah.
You're all right.
But before that, before you had the coffee shop, you just had the barbers, didn't you?
Yeah.
But I don't know if you had a street down. Didn't you move?
It was on the next block.
That's when I used to come when I was a proper kid.
Yeah.
Because all Liam and that are older than me. They'd like go to coffee shops and that.
I heard you took Bawley's Craft as well.
They did. Took Bawley's Craft.
Who I did?
Yeah. And Winoski's. You ever remember Winoski's?
Yeah, well, Winoski's closed and I opened.
He emigrated to Australia.
No, Florida. He went to America.
Oh, did he? Yeah. But I remember him emigrating.
Yeah, LA.
That was LA. On the further down, though, by the Mackies and that way, innit?
Yeah. And then day shut and another one shut and I opened, you know, fresh. And it's all right.
His prices were fucking expensive though, Jazz. Yeah.
Who me?
He was batty, John. Yeah.
I was £6.
Nah, they were all £4, £3.50s and that. John used to put £6 on the price.
Glad you gave for what you pay for. Do you know what I mean? If you want shite, both of those.
Winoski's was pure straight. It was literally cut up and cut down.
Yeah, in and out.
Off a short back and side.
Whereabouts on county are you from?
I'm from Delamore. I grew up on 99 Delamore Street.
Oh, did you? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
And then my ma still lives there. She lives in there. One of the streets now there.
Cool. The next one was Churchdale as a kid.
Next one was Churchdale. Yeah. The other side was Roxbury.
Roxburg? Did you live in Churchdale? Did you?
Yeah. Churchdale, Ruskin, Smeaton, and then the Westminster pub.
Yeah.
Remember the Westminster were all in there.
Yeah, and then it goes all Kirkdale then.
Yeah, then it goes
becomes Blaney.
Bullsville, doesn't it?
Say that.
And I'll have all the kids after me now.
You're like a fair time. But, oh no. So Darren, nice one. I don't know where to start now.
Yeah, where did we start?
Where,
what was it like growing up and what school?
The bright light of County Road.
Boss mate, I loved it, you know. I loved I don't, you know, I always like think about like people and they always say about their upbringings and the sort of cliche fight I think is a lot of people say, oh, me upbringing was hard.
Yeah.
You know, and that makes people think, oh, that's why he's tough. That's just total bullshit. It doesn't matter about your upbringing. And obviously, if you have a little bit of a tough upbringing, you know, it does make you tougher. Obviously, imagine the streets of Mexico or something like that.
Yeah,
like. But my upbringing was Sam. My mum and dad always provide was clothes on my back and, you know, stuff like that. But it was tough on the streets of County Road.
Well, I'm telling you now, when I was a kid growing up, County Road was all right, you know. We had, like, the Walton Festival. Yeah. It's only been
what
the last.
Was like. It was like proper neighbourly, weren't it?
Yeah.
I remember in Delamore, like in the summer, I'll never forget it. Like, all the neighbours would be on the step. And, like, do you know what I mean? I'd just be causing murder somewhere. I remember it just being. But it was neighbourly. It was nice. Wasn't it?
I remember a street party. Was it like the Queen's?
Yeah, I've still got the silver coin. My granddad gave me the silver coin. I can't remember what Queen's Jubilee it was or whatever, but I've got this silver coin my granddad gave me. I should have kept it intact because of fucking. Yeah, they come in like a little case, don't they?
Yeah, I remember.
I took out the case thinking I had money in that.
Through the box.
It's just worthless.
I mean, can I have a pack of Moscow, please?
That was when fucking Iron Brew was 19p and Freddo's a 10p, mate.
Yeah, you could get a few things in a nicker, couldn't you?
I'm glad I could get you a few things, mate.
Yeah, fucking say it.
Football club. Did you play for a football team?
I played for the Peacock, didn't I, Jess? Peacock. I was at the Peacock. Was that Brams? Do you ever remember Brams?
Brams, yeah. We used to play Mr. Brams, yeah.
Lad, bringing loads of memories. Do you know, so the Everton sports park, the swimming pools, and that. We used to play on there, Brams.
Yeah, that's where we used to play, yeah.
Yeah, and then you're older now. How old are you, Jazz?
I'm 91.
91?
I'm going to be 92 soon. What year were you, 90?
I'm 92.
92. But I was overage. We was a play against each other.
Probably, yeah.
I was always in the...
Yeah.
So in our league, there was the Brams, the Brahms, Custies, Bootle came in at one point, yeah, didn't he? They were good.
Custies, yeah.
Who else was it? The Eldonians.
The Eldonians, yeah. Wow.
Who else were
there? The Eldonians was like half of a match. Brahms, I remember. Yeah. Half of a match.
Who else were there?
Who's got beef here? Who's fucking...
Fuck yeah, we shouldn't be, talking here. There was these loads of teams, weren't they? Every community had their own team, didn't they?
But then after that, I moved on to the Peacock with Danny Vaughan and John Curtis' dad. They managed this, so Danny was like the assistant. And that we played. Danny Vaughan played for us, Cody Annan.
Cody's brilliant, weren't he?
Yeah, Cody was brilliant. Cody's drama. Do you know what, mate? Ask Danny Vaughan. I was all right myself, but I used to just get into all bother and that. But we were a good little team. Who was our fucking proper game?
I seen a picture of you last week on social media in a football team.
Yeah. Everyone had a skinner.
Yeah, I seen them, yeah.
Everyone had a skinner.
North. Yeah. Sweeps.
Yeah. We played on there, the BA.
The BA, yeah.
That was us. And then I remember everyone on the team will tell you this if you ever speak to them. I come on Sunday. I said to everyone, I said, I'm quitting this. And they're like, what? I'm going to be a fighter. And then the men were like, whoa. It's like, I'm going to go into Muay Thai, mate. Watch me. I'm going to be a fighter. And they're like, my dad was like saying to Danny John, yeah, he's just made his mind up. He wants to fight.
Was MMA even a thing there?
No, I got into I used to go boxing and that with my dad. And then I just got into the Muay Thai on Long Lane, you know, on TMAS.
Yep.
And then my coach there moved up to Highton. So I obviously went to Highton, but I got into the Muay Thai first. And then after like sort of a few years, I had my first professional fight when I was like 15. And then after like a few years, and I'd been traveling, I'd lived in Thailand and blah, blah, blah. You know, I was getting to the top. I was probably one of the top in England. And I just thought, you know what? I want to be an MMA fighter. You know what come over me? I was like, that just looks like the thing to do. Like, my thing was always, I want to be like the best fighter technically. I don't want to be the strongest or toughest. I want to be like, to be able to outsmart my opponent. Even when I was a kid, I had that mentality. And I remember thinking, that MMA looks like the game for me. Just the way all the arts are brought as one.
Yeah,
quite brutal, but if you look
just at the ultimate back, fighting, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I remember I half knew Terry Etim at the time and messaged him on Facebook. And I was like, come on, mate. I was like, Terry, can I come down to the... Obviously, I knew about the reputation of Ian Calvo. I was like, can I come down and do a session with you? And he's like, yeah, of course. And I went down, and for like 6 weeks, I'd done private sessions with Terry. And Terry knew I could fight. Like, you know, I was a good fighter. And Terry said, why don't you come and spar? I said, yeah, I'll come and spar. And I remember at the time, Colin was on the ring and he went, I'll go over and ask Colin. I remember he just like shimmied over and asked Colin or something. I heard Colin scream or something. I said, if he comes here, he can't go nowhere else and that. And I went in on the Monday for sparring. I remember going in because I've always had this man thinking, I'm going to battle this Terry. I'm going to battle this man on everyone in there. They're all getting it. And I just left there and just thought, Terry dropped me 3 times with body shots. Remember sparring and I held my own, but I didn't expect, like, because we're out of that Ben Thailand, Romania. I was like at the top of it in Muay Thai. I was a fucking good Muay Thai fighter, and they just wiped my eye, everyone in there. And I just remember sitting on the bus. I used to get 2 buses on the way home. I lived in Aintree at the time. I remember sitting there thinking, that has just opened my eyes. They are fucking killers. I want more of that.
Yeah. Couldn't you understand what had happened?
Nah, because wherever I was, what, like, without...
You rose to the top,
the top dog, yeah. Yeah. That's always been like, I'll go in a gym, I'll last to the top. And I just remember getting obliterated by everyone. Scano, Terry, Paul and Gary Kelly, Colin Farage, Greg Severs, loads of people in there. And I remember, I was on the bus, had a black eye. And loads of people at that point had quit. And I think that's why Colin took such a liking to me. Came in the next day with the same mentality. You want some more, do you, little puss? Yeah. Terry just fucked me again. And that went on for ages. And I remember being on tag. So I couldn't train in the night. And I remember coming to Colin and said, Colin, I'm on a tag. Can I train in the morning? He was like, well, that's professional fighters. That's the MMA. All the guys in the UFC and that. And I was like, I don't care. I want to fucking fight.
No way.
And he was like, okay, then come in. Because it was MMA. I was just Muay Thai. They were taking me down. They didn't hold back. But every day I was just like, this is what I want. And I'd come in early and I'd see Terry in the ring getting private tuition from Colin that for his fights and all the other guys. And I remember thinking, I want to be in that
spot. Exciting, isn't it?
I'm taking that spot from them. And lad, I just went on fucking ages like that. I just wanted to just be the top dog in Carbon. But wow, it was it was brutal. It was really brutal. Do you know what I mean?
That's interesting. You said you play football and then one day you made a decision. And what happened? Did you watch like a, like, the Karate Kid or something, and then got inspired.
That's what No, do you know what happened, mate? Right. Do you ever remember? Do you remember? It still is. Remember the gym on City Road?
Yeah. Fitty's gym.
Fitty's gym, yeah.
Like an alt-head.
And who used to train with Fitty? Small lad, Derry. Was it Derry? Used to always lift weights.
Oh, little with the bald, yeah.
Yeah, little Derry. Yeah. So my dad used to train there after work. He used to go after work. And he used to say to me, come on, that. And lad, obviously on County Road, you're always on the streets, aren't you? On your bikes, fucking. Do you remember the bus sheds before the bingo?
Yeah.
Do you ever remember
the
that?
Busy, yeah.
The bingo now was the bus sheds where you'd make ramps and that.
Used to grab leads off the roof.
Yeah. I used to just go to City Road gym with my dad and I remember two lads in the ring. One was Ozzy and the other lad was Steven and they were kickboxing and all that. And I just had, my mind wasn't just, I didn't want to box. I was thinking, I want to be able to do that as well because I've seen them like kicking over each other's heads and stuff. And I was like, I want to do that as well. And then I got into that and then I remember I was fighting loads and screaming. My dad went, what's up, son? And I was like, Dad, I like fighting. And he was like, okay, we'll take you to a proper gym. And so he took me to the proper gym on Long Lane. So then it was Sunday's footy and obviously doing the week training and that. And then it was obviously training Muay Thai and that at the same time. And I just came to it one day. I was like, I'm not after this footy no more. I want to fight. And that's when I told all the lads. And I remember they were all laughing. Like, what, Dad? And I told all my mates in school. I went to the Archies at the time. I was like, watch me be a fighter, boys. And they were like, really? Laughing. And I was like, yeah, watch.
Boss?
No one knows that. Like, do you know what I mean?
Well, now they do.
Yeah. So,
good stuff. Yeah, good stuff. Boss, that's so. How long were you in there before you was your first fight as an MMA? Do you have an amateur system in the MMA?
No, so I'd fought amateur Muay Thai and then went obviously professional Muay Thai, etc. But MMA, I had 3 or 4 amateur MMA bouts, and then I didn't turn professional in England. I turned professional in Brazil.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, so it was different. I had my first professional fight in Brazil. So I'd had all my amateur fights in the Olympia. And then straight away, I was in Brazil training to be a professional. So that's sort of how my... I had a short amateur career. As to say, some of these lads are amateur. They'll have a load of fights, be the champion of whatever organisation they're in, and then go pro. And the same thing. My direction was totally different.
So you started off in Liverpool, obviously. Yeah. And then you built up a little bit there. And then did you decide to move to Brazil then?
Yeah. And then I just went off to Brazil.
Muay Thai put you in good stead, hasn't it? Obviously, you can't turn pro, but no experience, can you?
No, of course. At that point in Brazil, 2013, the MMA was sort of good.
Yeah.
You know, because I've been training at Carbon for so long, obviously, I'm training there, it's phenomenal. So I did have a good understanding to go pro, but Brazil's different, mate. Brazil's fucking the land of just all mad killers from favelas who are just all black belts. So it was a bit different, but I was prepared. Do you know what I mean?
It's like you put yourself, it's like you... dived in the deep end and everything you've done until learned to swim while you're there.
Charles, all know the same. You know, boxing, you start, you go through the amateurs, you go through the pros and everything. I just went amateur, boom, pro, but not even pro in England. It's not like I went amateur yet. I'm in Colin, I want to go pro. I went amateur.
You missed a lot of steps, didn't you?
Missed a lot of steps, yeah. So amateur, right? You're in Brazil, you've got to speak a new language, you've got to earn money, you've got to fucking whatever. And that's you've got to go pro.
So how far are you in the Muay Thai world? So.
Now I don't know. Do you know what I mean? Probably go back and get fucked. Do you know what, mate? I don't want to sit here and blow my own trumpet, but I was very, very, like, I had a very good understanding of fighting. I wasn't like a brute guy, strength. Technical abilities were really good. So, you know, at that point in time, you know, as I say, in England, I'd fought on a big show called Rumble at the Reebok. I was probably, you know, one of the top guys in England. And around the world, it's different to say how you are in the world. You know, the way it is with boxing and then there's so many different organisations in Muay Thai. You could never come out and say you're the number one unless you were on a specific, you know what I mean? It's very,
because you don't fall in the same rankings, do you?
Let's just have it. If I went back to Muay Thai, I'd be the top guy. I've got different skills from MMA, you know, that a lot of a lot of Muay Thai guys.
You're filling loads of little gaps.
Yeah, they're not like sufficient with their hands. You know, it's more of, they use the hands to set up kicks and knees and elbows, but I've got the hands now and other little things like trips and the clinch and that. So I reckon if I went back to Muay Thai, I'd be the top guy.
I've always wondered how MMA could, as a boxing fighter, how MMA could I gain any experience as a MMA, saying the MMA, what would help me in boxing? Does it? Do the transfer?
The clinch, you know, because there's different using with the clinch in MMA, it's about clinching and taking down, and maybe you could learn some, I don't know, trips to like make your opponent trip and just catch him with an uppercut, something like that. Yeah. No.
That's what he's saying. If it goes to the just done the Muay Thai, he takes all the other aspects and applies it to that a little bit. And do you know what I mean? That's going to give it an edge.
I think
it would happen.
You know, the way we're coming into this, there's YouTubers fighting boxers and everything now, and we're coming into this era. And whether you agree with it or you don't, it's here. And everyone is talking about it, right? I've sort of always had the thing of, you'll get a lot of people, I'm a boxer, MMA shit. Or you'll get MMA, boxing shit, doesn't make. Or you'll get Muay Thai, MMA shit. I'm of the understanding of, take something from everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Take it all. Do you know what I mean? Don't have a straightforward mind. Like, I'm going to be a wrestler, just a wrestler. Take stuff from every single martial art you can get and put it together. And that is what being an ultimate martial artist is all about. Mm. So, you know.
Ultimate fighting, couldn't you? Yeah. Really?
A lot of the old-time boxers, a lot of my mates, like, who were like, you know, in the 50s, now old-time, that fucking MMA.
Jesus, don't
you? Rolling around. And I'm like, stand up then and see if you can stop me. Yeah. They're like, oh, no, I wouldn't go that far. But I had loads of my mates, even from, like, they're all old-time, like, fuck that MMA. But they're obviously, it's different. We're coming into a different time now, do you know what I mean? Where MMA's, you know, it's up there with boxing. I'm still the biggest fan ever of boxing, but MMA's becoming big, and obviously you've got these...
It's a main stage for a combination of all the fighting styles, isn't it, really?
Social media's helping everything as well, and information is so accessible, and it's so quick.
Yeah.
You know, look at me the other day on the phone to the police. That went round in, what, a minute? Yeah. Around the world. Not just Liverpool, around the world.
Karen Till.
Yeah, Karen Till.
Where did the Karen come from? What was...
So it wasn't really a Karen moment, was it? Because it was me actually, you know... I'm sort of a little bit, I shouldn't have maybe, I've got another video actually of before I went live, and I was very calm in that video, but the Karen Till moment sort of came from, I thought when I was like driving, I was thinking, proper Karen, because I make fun of like all them Facebook mums, live, laugh, love and that. I was thinking that's a Karen Till moment, that's all got me here.
Yeah.
And I thought, I'll have a laugh with this now. Imagine if I had a comment, who's calling me, how you cunt? You gotta embrace.
You're frustrated, I can tell. Do you know what?
I don't have to sit here and lie and go, you've done this. I was in the garage in Bayard Farm, being on there 10 times a day, getting baby milk and waters, mate, just convenient. And I come out, and I'd seen the other officer who was in there. He was in the queue of the subway, and then he actually said, you okay, mate? I went, you're all right. And as I've come out, I'm just like going back to my car like that. And then I just seen the Volvo busy guy, he just jumps out, but he just jumps right in my vision. Where's your mask? I don't need to wear one, mate, I'm exempt. And he was like, show me proof. And I was like, mate, honestly, I was like, I broke my nose, I've had sat. He was like, what a street fighter are we? And I thought, mate, how fucking misguided are you to just make an assumption like that? Yeah. Like, no, I'm a professional fighter, actually. And as I was going to go to my car, he sort of like grabbed me hand, and that's when I turned around,
did he
get the fuck off my hand now? And he's seen it, and like, he did let go. Like, I don't want to say, but he fucking shit himself. And then like, as I'm going to my car, he's just following me, and I meant, mate, I was like, mate, what do you want? I went, I know I don't need to provide proof. If I say I'm exempt, that's the end of it. I've seen the government fucking guidelines and whatever there is. And he just wanted to carry on. So then when I'm in my car, I was filming on normal video at first. I was very calm. And then that's when I went live. And obviously you've all seen, you know, what went on. And a lot of people said to me, why don't you just wear a mask? I was like, you know what? If I had a mask, I'd put on a fucking problem. It's the point of the fact of the matter is I'm exempt. And that should be the end of it with him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm not going to sit here and say, I'm right, he's wrong. There's two sides to it. Everyone's seen the video, and that was it.
Your job's worth,
and I'm Karen Till.
I seen it, you know, we all know that type of police officer is good. Good cops and bad cops and the sort of thing, but we all know that
type
bad of guy.
Cop, aren't you? I'm good cop, he's bad cop.
You know what, mate? I get stopped a lot of times, I've never had a problem really with police officers. Most police officers are fans of fighting, aren't they? Fans of boxing, fans of MMA. So they're usually, oh, you okay, mate, and that. But you do get the odd one who just wants to, I don't know, make an example maybe.
I find with police, it depends how you speak to them. Like, if you're nice to them, or not be nice, or just be on their level type of thing almost, you know what I mean? They're all right with you. But if you start, if you're a cunt off, straight off, that's it.
Years ago, remember what I said to him as well, this is funny. I said, mate, I'll be going live on Instagram just for my own protection. And he turned around, he went to, what, who to? Your friends and family? They could like, you know, and I was like, mate, you're just barking up the wrong
team. How many followers have you got?
I've got a few fucking, I think I've got like a mil point two. mil. I was thinking, mate, this is ain't the tree you want to be barking up, you know? Can you imagine if at night seeing all them memes that come out and that? Oh my God, I should have just left
I was thinking about it. He'd be good to them now, won't he?
Yeah.
Like, no.
Yeah.
But so Darren, so you were doing Muay Thai in Liverpool.
Muay Thai, John.
Muay Thai.
Was that what the cows do?
That is, I'm throwing the water now. Oh no, he's fucking accent's changed. Anyway, so you started that. And then so you joined the other gym with the likes of Scano and stuff.
Yeah, so I was in Height and Sapphires.
Yeah.
With my coach Si Audley. And then
Shout out Si,
yeah. And then I felt like I just at that point, you know, a lot of things were going on. I watched UFC 100, yeah, which was Brock Lesnar, Frank Mir, and Terry Etten was on the card. And I'd heard of Terry, but I'd never seen what he was like. And I remember just watching and thinking, wow, he's a beast. And I had him as a Facebook friend and that, you know, Facebook card until. And I was like, hey, Terry, can I come down and train me? And he was like, yeah, Santil, no problem. So I'd done a few ground privates on the ground, you know, personal sessions and that. And, you know, he taught me a few things, but I remember thinking, I want to be at this gym. I want to actually train alongside Terry. As an idol now. And Colin's not the friendliest. You know, nowadays, Colin's like, fucking, couldn't be closer. But I remember he asked Colin, I could come and Colin was like, yeah. And then that was it, mate. I was just that team carbon. Then I was just dedicated, loyal, all them things that, you know, come along with it. And the only thing was, I just wanted to fucking fight and train and just be the best. And I'll be honest with you, I took a lot of heavy punishments in the start. I remember it was tough, mate. It used to take it out of me, and then obviously it went good being on fucking tag and then having to get two buses home. So I'd get two buses in the morning, two buses at night. It was tough, you know, it was really brutal. But we've all had brutal, you know, that's what I said. I don't like the cliche. I don't like to sit here and say, oh, my path was tougher than yours. Every fighter has it tough and brutal. That you've got to have a tough and brutal. Otherwise, when you're in the fight and the pressure starts building, if you've never felt that in the gym, you're not gonna know how to deal with it then. Yeah. And then. That's why a lot of our training.
So you're getting harder there, aren't you? You're getting harder early on.
Yeah, I think the fight is in the gym, innit?
Every day you're sore going to and from the gym as well, aren't you?
And you're doubting yourself. I don't want to do this today. You have your days where you doubt yourself and everything. Do you know what I mean?
There's a moment, John, where you wake up, you're in camp and that, and you just sit on the side of the bed of a mon and you just think, another day. It's easy.
What am I doing?
Your whole body's just in pain, do you know what I mean? It's that builds you, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
So how did you get to Brazil? What happened there?
Obviously, a lot of people, you know, you don't know the incident. I had an incident, you know, I got stabbed in that. And at that point, you know, as much as I was training and fighting, I was, you know, one of these, I wasn't a fucking, like, cunt and on, but I was a little scally, you know, I was fucking a bit mad. Still a bit mad, but more calm now. Apart from the other week with Karen and Petty Officer for But I remember after it, I didn't go to see my mum, I didn't go to see my dad or not, and I went to the gym. And in the gym, there was Scano, there was all the guys, Terry and that, and Colin was sat by the ladies, and I remember I was on a crutch, and went over to Colin. Colin was just like, son, what are you doing? He's like, I see you here there. He's like, you're having murder with these firms, and you're doing this, and you're doing that, and you're going to either end up in jail or...
Was it like this for you at this point, Aaron? Yeah. Was it that way or that way?
It wasn't. I don't want to say
you'd always had that love for fighting.
Fighting at the end in jail. Yeah. A lot of fighters say that. I don't want to say that, but you know, it could have been. But I was more in the gym.
But this could have damaged this.
Yeah, it could have. Yeah, potentially being in Liverpool. You know, when you're in where you live, there's a lot of distractions as well, stuff like that. And Jazz has probably said it. And Carl just said, listen, you know, Brig, who trains us, this was the coach in Brazil. He's gonna take you now. If you go to Brazil, he's like, do you want to be a champion? I was like, I want to be a champion. I was like, what do you want to be? I said, I want to be a UFC world champion. Because in my eyes, you're the best in the world. Then he's like, okay, trust what I say. Go to Brazil.
So this is your coach at the time,
Coach Colin. I was like, okay, when should I go? And I was thinking he's gonna say like, in a few months, not even go the weekend.
Fucking hell.
And I was like, really? He's like, go the weekend. I was like, okay. I went to the offices. These officers, you know, like he had a computer and that. And I said, book me a flight to Brazil. And he's like, what? Book me a flight to Brazil. I'm going the weekend. He's like, oh, all right. And I booked it for the 24th of December on my birthday, 2012.
Yeah, before Christmas?
Yeah. And best day to fly, by the way, if you want to, like, no one in the airport. It's fucking great. Yeah. So I had a bit of money and that. And I got me money together. And I was like, okay. And I remember Carl took me to the airport and that. And I was like, Carl, I'll see you when I see you. And he was like, I'll see you soon, son. And I was thinking, I'm coming back here, but I'm not asked.
Yeah.
And then I went off, was on the plane, and I was just thinking, what the fuck's going on here? Got to Brazil, and like, you know, people go to travel destinations, you know, like Spain.
Had you been to South America before?
Never. Dubai and Turkey. Brazil ain't none of that, mate. Brazil is beautiful. And all these great things. And at the same side, it's fucking like mental.
Yeah, that's
like,
what I...
Mental. Like, I don't even know how to put it into words or explain it. And I remember just getting it arriving in São Paulo. And when you arrive in São Paulo, you see the favelas. They build on the mountains, don't they?
Yeah, I've seen
what
those.
What is a favela?
Sorry, Josh.
What is a favela?
So, not the best of my knowledge, but it's like they build on mountains, favelas.
The community, like, these them little houses. Like
brick houses, no windows in or nothing. My mate now, who lives here, Eric, I've been to his, where his family grew up in a favela in the Amazon, and I ain't never seen nothing like it. He's like, till you ever go in here without me, brother? And I was like, why? He's like, because they will just shoot you. Like,
really?
Oh. And then he took me to his mother's house. There wasn't a window in sight, just a little hut. And I was like, how many live in there? He was like, 8, my sister. And I was like, wow, brother. And this was after a few years I'd been in Brazil, and I remember Brig picked me up from the airport, and Brig sort of just lashed me. As much as Brig, like, loved me, he just lashed me in there and was like, fend for yourself, kid. And I was like, okay, then. It's time. And I did.
How old were you at this point?
At that point, I was 19, 20. And I was like, okay, you know what? I'll fend for myself. I'm going to do everything it takes. Learned the language, obviously in the dad and tilt fucking being there very, you know, 2 months, 3 months, I'd already impregnated the girl, so I was like, fucking hell, already putting little tills all over the map on myself. And so then that was bad because at that time I was just training, coming back. I wasn't asked about money, wasn't asked about where my next meal was coming from. That's the truth. I was like, I'm just, every day Connor texts me, who beat you today in the gym? I'd be like, so-and-so. He's like, fucking kill him tomorrow. Hey, go in there.
Was he in touch with you all the time?
Yeah, over there. I didn't have a phone over Twitter. I'd go to the internet and that over Twitter. And then, you know, the girl, obviously, I was seeing at the time, she got pregnant, and she was like, I'd understand if you're not going to take care of the baby. And I was like, fuck, I'll take care of it. I was like, wait, I need to get a job now as well. So I started teaching privates out there in Muay Thai to earn money. So I was teaching privates, training, trying to find a little fucking gaff to fucking, because I had a young one, you know, about to be born. And then fighting at the same time. I was fighting all the time.
In this environment that you...
Yeah.
Just a completely different world.
All blabbity blah blah. And Brazil's a massive fucking country. Fighting there 15 hours away on the bus. Fighting down there by Colombia 9 hours. Just here, there. Just trying to build on that.
Obviously, you're fighting for nothing, aren't you?
At that time, it was 300 reals, 400 reals, which is £100. Yeah. No, it ain't nothing. It ain't nothing.
Because you have to build up a fan base and a network to sell tickets to be on these top bills where we live in this country, yeah, don't we?
Here it is like that, and yeah, there it was like that, but not in the same breath. It was a bit different because the way here, shows will get booked for 6 weeks. There was a million shows every Saturday, Sunday there in Brazil because it's so big.
Yeah.
So my coach, Brig, would say, right, there's a fight there in fucking Maringá, which is fucking hours and hours and hours away. Should we go? Get ready. Right, cut your weight. Blah, blah, blah. 2 weeks' time. Go. And that was it, mate, just building and fighting. And when I got there, I searched who the number one guy was in the welterweight. And I said to Briggs, is he the number one? He was like, yeah, he's the number one. I was like, I'll beat him, watch. And I did, in my debut.
Wow.
In your debut as well?
Became the number one.
So. Wow.
So what was that like, a fight going after
being the number one? You know what, Jazz? Like, as much as I fucking absolutely adore Liverpool and love it, and people are lovely, and even England, Brazil is just another in itself, like the beauty of the country, but also it's good to see the way the country is,
culture,
like the culture, the way people are, the poverty, all stuff like that. And probably the best times of my life was the years spent in Brazil.
It's stepping out of being in England and that, and then seeing that you see England for what it is as well.
You know yourself, Jez, you've probably been for camps and that, and you know, you go camps here all do Monday. I went there but not knowing when I was coming back.
How long were you there?
I was there 4 years.
Was
exactly,
yeah,
to the day. I came back the 24th.
No way.
4 years later. That's 4 years to the day. But that was for me. And then one day it was like Carl, spoke to Carl a bit. Carl was like, now's your time to come back, son, and take over.
It's like a Jean-Claude Van Damme film.
I've done that.
Got double impact.
Yeah.
A one-way ticket, really, isn't it?
I've done it myself. One-way ticket. And it became even more one-way when, you know, my daughter, Bella, she'd be 7 in March. 7 years of age, fucking. Wow. You know, it became more of a fucking, like, this is my home now. I've got a daughter here. You know what I mean? It's not as easy to just get your daughter and come back to England, you know.
So,
So you've sort of gone from a boy to a man there, haven't you? You've grown up there.
Because, you know, I had to get a... It wasn't like, right, you know, like you know, I always think of it like it wasn't like when, you know, if you meet a girl here and she gets pregnant and her family helps out and, you know, my family helps out. It was sort of me and her.
Yeah.
Because her family lived 15 hours south. So there was no help there. It was sort of me. No help from no one. Just having to think, right, how am I going to fend for this little girl here? Mm. How am I going to do it?
In a foreign country
chasing
as well.
Chasing me dream at the same time. Because John, I could have easily said, right, I'll put fighting on hold now and go and get a normal job. Because at that time, I already had a Brazilian passport, you know, citizenship. I could have easily done that, gone and got a job in one of the gyms and just trained and teached and whatever. I didn't. I stayed on track. I stayed on form, which I think is really important, you know, especially for anyone who's out there deciding whether it's getting a bit tough in fighting. Thinking, oh, I'll just get on my job and I'll put fighting on hold. Don't do it. It's a mistake.
Mm.
You know.
That's hard though, darling. To say I just stuck to my craft, that's every day when you're living in it, that's the hardest thing in the world, isn't it? When it's easier to make a living elsewhere.
Funny story, right? I remember every end of the month, Fridays had come, and the girl who used to take the rent. She was a woman, she was about 55, 60. She was got on well with her, she was a pain in the ass. Though the day of the rent, she'd be there banging at the door and be like, oh, you little slag.
The probably woman.
Get behind the couch. And I remember I had a choice, yeah. It fucking makes me laugh this till this day. I had a choice, right, every time rent day was due. I had a choice because sushi in Brazil is proper fucking lovely, expensive. Pay me rent. Sushi. Can you guess what won every time? Sushi. I think I paid me rent for 6 months. And I swear, honestly, every night I'd be sat there with a belly full of sushi. Think, should have just fucking paid this rent, mate. Why didn't I just pay the rent? And that was it, mate. You know, just little qualities like that. Just fucking.
You must be so grateful for that whole experience.
Honestly, I am. And I'm still grateful for the people I have there. You know, my daughter, Bella, she's got a godfather out there, Omar, who's my best friend. He's if you've seen where he lived, mate, you just fucking change your whole perception on life. He lives on like a mountain just outside the city, and the mountain overlooks every other mountain and the city. And he lives in like a 10-bedroom house with parrots. He had a cheetah. He had 5 dogs. Here's a mad one. My daughter used to stay there of a weekend with me. Her mother lived in the city and I lived there with all that. And one morning I was taken out, she'd come to the gym with me, you know, she was my little mascot in the gym, and she stood on like this red and black thing, and I thought, what the fuck's that? So like I've dragged her onto like a grass bit we've had, and I seen Omar walking around. I said, Omar, what's that? And Omar, my friend, used to breed snakes, and he said, Darren, that's the most poisonous snake in the world. In the world, bar of state.
His daughter had stood on it?
Yeah. Coral, it's called, searching on Google, it's called a coral. That they're red and black and a touch of white. He said, Darren, it's the most poisonous snake in the world. He went, if it had black spots or something like that, it's not venomous. So if it's bitter, she wouldn't have died. He said, if this were the bitter, she'd have been dead.
Wow.
And I just went, what the fuck? And here's another mad one. About 3 in the morning one time, yeah, because mate, in that mountains there was any kind of creature. That day we'd bought some pizza and chocolate cake, and I remember at 3 in the morning, I was still awake, and I thought, oh, that chocolate cake's still on the fridge there. I'm going to get it. Creeping out into the kitchen, no word of a lie, mate. Yeah, it was dark. I seen these, like, eyes, and I thought, that's not the dogs. It was a spider about that.
Wow.
With its fucking tusks near it, just looking at me, and mate, I'm terrified. And I went, whoa! What the fuck is that? Mate, it was humongous. I don't know what it was. It was just like that. And I was like, fucking hell, that's moved in on it, son, mate. Ran, and we had Alsatians, got the Alsatians, and the Alsatians come in and fucking killed it. I remember, I was like, that Omar, there's a spider. And he was like, fuck off, you dickhead. He's like, there's a big spider. He come out, he went, fucking hell, the size of that still. Mate, that was just every day. The beard, all these mad bears landing in there.
Like Tyson in the hangover when he goes in.
Yeah. It was a pleasure to live there. It was a real pleasure, honestly.
No way.
Yeah.
So, you got the phone call.
Did you get the cake?
I got the cake. Don't worry about that, Jazz. I got that. I think he was after the cake.
Six forks.
The spider was after the cake, and so was I. But I got the cake, yeah.
Sorry, Jazz. I just funny that you mistake the dog for the spider. Was it that fucking big?
John, honestly, right? Listen, like, even a little one, I'm fucking terrified. This was like going in, the fridge is there, and the cake's there, and I remember I just seen these two little eyes, and I was like, that's not the dog, that. And I turned the light on, and it was just completely still, like that. And I just went, whoa, ran out, opened the door, and the dogs come in. I was like, go to the kitchen, go, 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 go. And he killed it, and that.
Did he kill it?
Yeah, he killed it. It was like that then. I was like, see, you're not that fucking big, are you?
I used to be petrified of spiders, right? I was in Australia. I was watching this film with the baby's mum, and I got up and said, do you want a butty? And as I went like that, this fucking spider the size of my hands went behind his curtain. And I was like, what the fuck? And I jumped on the island in the kitchen. And here's his, he's about 4 foot with a brush trying to find his fucking spider. It was a huntsman, I think.
Yeah, huntsman.
So I had me on his little island for about, I'm there for about an hour. I shit myself. So then I go into the bathroom and I get in the shower because I think, and I shut these doors and I thought, it can't get me from in here. Anyway, then I got a shower because I felt dirty after seeing the spider because I knew the spider was in the house in this fucking...
It's all right when you see them, when you can't see them, that's the problem, yeah, innit? Where the fuck's it gone?
There's only so long I can stay in the fucking shower for. So eventually I got into the bed and I thought, this little cunt, well, big cunt could get me at any time. But you know what happens? I had this little moment of realisation. I realised I could take that spider in a fight, right? And this is what I thought to myself. I could beat that spider in a fight. And ever since then, I've never been scared of spiders.
Did you fight it?
Cut that bit, Chase.
Did you fight it?
No, but I had a phobia of spiders. And I'm not scared of spiders anymore.
That means I would be fighting those spiders, Jay.
Anyway, moving on.
yeah.
Sorry,
that's
man.
The story.
Cut that. So you got the phone call to come back.
Yeah.
To the UK. It was like, right, let's fucking hit it.
Yeah, well, I'd made my debut in Brazil in the UFC. So then, on part of the dream, the goal had been made. I never forget where I was at the time in Brazil. You all like smoke weed and that. And I went to my friend Tim's, who's the wrestling coach. He's in America, actually. And this was after a fight. I'd fought for a title in Brazil against a guy called Midnight and knocked him out in the fourth round. And then I remember Briggs saying, you know, stay ready, be ready. It could come in a few months, you call. And I was like, okay. So this was the week after, and I went to Tim's, and Tim was like a good cook, and he cooked us up a scran and that. And we had a little smoke on that, and we were listening to some tunes. And next minute, I see me phoning. This was about 12:30 at night. It's Brig. I thought, fucking hell, something must have happened. So I answered, he went, what are you doing right now? And I had a mouthful of mash. And I went, I'm eating. He went, right, cut your weight, you fat cunt. You're fighting in the UFC. I went, what? He went, yeah, wow. 8 days' time. Someone, there's been a pullout. You're fighting the guy you over wants to fight at Wendell. You know, the number one. I went, really? He went, what's your weight like now? I said, no, you know, I'm heavy. I said, but I can make it. He went, son, this is our time, son. Put the phone down.
The call.
Celebrated with Tim. We opened a bottle of wine, had a glass of wine and a little smoke. And then... was it, mate?
Did you carry on? Did you think,
oh, I'll start tomorrow? Yeah. Don't worry about that. I had the food. I thought I'll start tomorrow.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, one of them Monday.
So you had 8 days?
At that time. So when he drank me the 12:30 of it, was easy to the next day, but it was 9 days. So the next day would have been 8 days. And it was just...
For the people listening, that, what's it like for you? Because it's not like that call, is it? When you've been working so hard and the call comes.
And as I say, Jazz, 8 days, 10 days, 2 days... want to take it, because that was one part of the dream, getting to the UFC. It's so hard getting to the UFC. As Terry always says to me, when a lot of people say they want to be fighters, he always says, but do you really want to be a fighter? You know, it's such a struggle, because everyone, let's say in MMA, you know, obviously I don't know as much in boxing nowadays, everyone's fighting to get into the UFC. That's half the battle. The other battle then is, what have you got into the UFC for? Have you got into the UFC just to go around and tell people you're in the UFC? Have you got into to make money, or have you got in it to be the best? I know what, you know, with the money and all of fame alongside that comes with it, the goal remains the same. And just that feeling of sitting there with a glass of wine thinking, right, half the battle. And I remember thinking, and I've done this battle fucking way harder than anyone else. So fuck them. This cunt ain't beating me. And I remember this Wendell, he was an intimidating cunt. You know, he was a big guy, you know, fucking muscular. And I just remember thinking, mate, you aren't beating me on my baby, forget that shit. 8 days' time, it was in Goiânia, which is from the north of Brazil. Made, cut the weight and that, and knocked him out in the second. And then the real thing was that I got on. At the time, I walked out for the Brazilian crowd, they were all booing me. Like, boos and jeers. And I remember thinking, you know, cheering when I'm finished. Yeah. When I finished, Briggs said to me, do the interview in Portuguese.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah, Briggs, no, I'm not confident enough. He's like, The translator walked in. I said, mate, we don't need you. And the translator was like, what? I grabbed the mic and I just started spouting all this Portuguese. And I could see the fucking arena was jam-packed. And I could see everyone looking at each other like, is this fucking white boy Englishman speaking Portuguese? And I remember saying to them, don't be booing me. I'm one of yous. I've got a fucking Brazilian daughter. I'm half Brazilian. I'm one of yous. Don't boo me ever again. And then fucking stadium.
Really?
Wow. After that, every interviewer came to me backstage.
Wow, fucking.
And it was like this reborn fucking half Englishman who took Brazil into his like custody and treated it as own, respected the fucking language, learned it. It's not, I haven't went there expecting them to speak English. I've went there, I'll learn your language. Yeah. Give me some time, I'll learn your language. And that was it then, I was considered one of them.
And you won their acceptance that day?
I won their acceptance, I remember.
And were you all rooting for you after that?
Yeah, because I remember at that time I was quite well known in the city and that, but I got to be very well known. Everyone was like, oh my God, it's the fucking half Brazilian guy, Darren and that. And it was fucking amazing. Honestly, it was so fucking surreal.
So you obviously stood out like Canelo in Mexico. The white man
stands out. Only I was like this fucking white as a brush English lad, just fucking absolutely speaking fluent Portuguese. Like I can read, write, I can do it all in Portuguese. But I not like the way they teach it in a school. Slang, like I speak the slang way, because I remember thinking, I don't want to learn correct Portuguese. I want to learn it like all the lads are speaking in the gym. So I analysed and they'd say words that I'd know was a word, but it was different, and I'd be like that's slang.
Yeah.
Take that into your memory and have it.
So like if someone who's a foreigner speaks with a Scouse accent, we know you learned in Liverpool, people in Portugal know where you learned to speak. Would they buy your accent?
Like the dialect and the accent type of thing.
Do you know, I used to play a game with myself. I used to try and mimic the accent well enough so that they wouldn't even recognise I wasn't from Brazil. Obviously, a lot of the time they'd get onto it, but there were sometimes people wouldn't get onto it. Because every time if I'd go on a shop and that'd speak, they'd be onto so that I wasn't a Brazilian. They'd have to give me a second look. So I used to challenge myself to like have that fluency so much that they couldn't even get onto my accent. But they all call me like the Scouse of Geese, because you can't add that Scouse.
Do a little bit of Portuguese for us, lad.
What do you want me to say? How are we?
Say how are we?
Como está?
Como está? Oh, brilliant. Yeah. So you made your debut in Brazil, and then you come home?
And then I had a second fight in Dublin. I popped my shoulder in the fight. Still, I drawed in the fight. We got the fight of the year, one of the fight of the year, fight of the night. And then I came home. After that, I'd done my surgery in Brazil. So I'd done a year's, rehab surgery in Brazil, and then Colin was like, right, it's time to come home and take over. And then I just came home, fought in Sweden against the top prospect in Europe in the UFC, beat him, fought in Rotterdam, beat him, and I fought Cowboy, beat him, fought in the Echo Arena, beat Wonderboy, and obviously had my title fight, lost that, then lost again to Masvidal, then came back in Madison Square Garden, co-main, beat Gaslam, who just nearly defeated the champ. And then I fought now against the ex-champs, Whittaker. We had like a 5-round battle. He just edged it on, points. But that's the long cold of it.
So how many years had you fought in Liverpool for? By the time you left Colin and come back, how many times?
That had been like 4 or 5 years.
Wow. Was it nice coming back?
Yeah, it was, because I'd never actually fought professionally in England.
Yeah.
And just think about it, my first ever fight was selling out the Echo Arena against one of the top strikers in the UFC, Wonderboy.
I've always wondered, the fighters that we're built up against, you'll have stepping stones, don't you, in every sport. Are the stepping stones in Brazil tougher than the stepping stones in England?
I had to say, because I did have some easy fights.
Yeah.
But the thing in Brazil is, because they're like fucking national sports, is like jiu-jitsu, every single one of them know what to do. The ground game, that's so you go to the ground, it's just fucking touch and miss whether they're going to snap your neck in half or snap your arm. So, as much as I'd say, some of them were easy to step in some fights, it's still a little bit of a danger, because they all know how to grapple. All know how to grapple, do you know what I mean?
So, moving forward, what's your plans now? Obviously, your goal
is fighting on the 10th, the 11th, the 12th, or the 15th of April. I don't know the exact date against the Marvin Vettori. He's Italian. He's number 5. I'm number 4. So this is sort of a title eliminator. Whoever wins this gets a title shot.
Brilliant.
you know, I'm still on the dream, Jazz, just like yourself. I'm just on this fucking path to greatness. I always say it's a path to greatness. I don't want to just be one of these guys. Oh, he's in the UFC. There's Darren Till, he done this. And I want people to say he was one of the greatest.
Yeah. Fucking brilliant.
I was speaking to Bomber last week and I was saying, he was asking him about what is it like once you become world champion and stuff like that. And he was saying, these are the best days now, becoming the champion. When you look back, they are the days.
If you've noticed, Jazz, even like with Tony, I've seen the same thing happen with him. Every fighter who seems to retire, you start seeing spells of them after that. They just want to come back. It's like they just fucking can't let go. And even Tony, you can see that he just wants to come back and fight.
Yeah.
And it must be that going home and you're bored and you're not having someone telling you you've got a diet or...
It's once you've achieved your goal, you suppose you lose sense of purpose, don't you? So you want that back again, don't you?
Yeah. I'd say you, as a fighter, you lose sense of everything because your day to day is getting up, training. Yeah. And as you say, you've got an hour slot here to do this 2 hours, but your day to day is train, sleep, eat. And then all that goes away, and it's like, well, I can eat now, but I'm bored of that.
Well, that's so long, doesn't it?
So have you found lockdown, Dan? I watched some of your lives. I just love it when you come on, you sit there with Raw Dog. You just sit there and you just say fuck all. And people are just giving you shit. You just look at the comment and you go.
You know what, John? Social media, it is actually a great time to be alive, and it's probably a bad time to be alive, because social media is like this thing now where I don't even know where to start. Like, I've just created, the way I've created my social media platform is, there's no limitations, you know. Say what you want to say, don't get offended, and have fun with it. Every post I do or will do, I don't take myself too serious. I don't talk about what COVID, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm not here to tell anyone to do this, to do that. I'm not here to say this or that. I'm here to just put a meme that I find funny.
Yeah.
And if you find it funny, all my mates, let's have a laugh. And then the guys that don't find it funny, I'll just call them out. I don't ever have arguments on social media. I'll just sort of say something to someone. Like, I'll say something attacking them, and they attack me back. And I won't get into it like, oh, mate, you shouldn't be like that. And I just think people do that, you know, wanker.
At the start, though, that when you started getting negative comments, would you look into your profiles? Because I know I was. Where's this fella from? Where's he working on fire?
Do you know what, Judge? Because do you know a lot of people say that? And you just,
I don't think you care at all.
I just don't, John, I just couldn't give a rat's ass.
If anything, when I seen you go on that lag that time, and you just, I don't know if you do that all the time, but you just said nothing, but you knew what you were doing.
I've created it like that as well. Like, people know they can come to my comment section and be like that. Obviously, there's sometimes people are a lot brutal, and a lot of people can't take it. Even like, you know, my girlfriend will say sometimes, and everyone will say, oh, lad, don't put me on your social media, they're fucking brutal on there. I've sort of created that because of how brutal I am. I'm quite brutal on it. But essentially, there's probably people like, I don't like the way Darren is on social media. You know, I'm not a bother. It's all about positivity and all like that. That's just me. I just like putting a meme out there and, you know, letting you see a little bit of what I'm doing. Yeah, obviously I'll put sponsorships and that on there. That's just my social media. I'm not going to go on social media telling you to do this, telling you to do that, saying this, saying that, saying I know the secret behind COVID. I know the secret behind lockdown. Do you know what I mean? It's just there.
We're all different flavours, and we're not to everyone's taste, are we? And you just express yourself the way you want it. You know what I mean?
And if anyone comes on, be prepared. You know, that I just, it's sort of like a comment. If someone comments with something like negative, I'll just attack them. I'll just attack them in any way, shape or form. And probably gained a lot of followers by doing that the first lockdown. I just wanted to just have fun with it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it is serious. I know a lot of people have died. I've had people close to me who've had caught the COVID, and it is a real thing. But you know, you just got to lighten the mood, same as you, mate. You know, you come from, obviously I know you, John, but you come from nowhere with all these how are we's. And I just seen, I was in ours one day and someone said, you've seen these how are we's? And I was like, nah. And he's like, John? I was like, John, who, John May? And I was like, John May Sweeps? Like, yeah. And I just see it and I went, oh my God. That is Kenny fucking the beard.
Callum.
How are we fucking, what's his face with the camera? He's the best. He got the fucking ice cream on his.
Yeah, do you like that one?
Lad, like, that's just what this shit's about, mate.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? And that's what I try to do, saying to Jazz. It's like, that how people keep calling your attention seekers and all that. It's like, I'm being creative. If what I'm doing, being creative, makes people fucking smile, mate, I'm fucking happy. Do you know what I mean?
A lot of people are out there to grab attention and do it. Like, there's a lot of people who the script and things and this, and overnight when lockdown happened, I think I put a fucking thing about it, and fucking overnight everyone seemed to become like this personal trainer and overnight chef and overnight, come on guys. Like, I just sat there to me and I can't stand people like that, you know, I just, and it's probably bad of me to say because it's like, they're just trying to think you're positive, but I'm just like, right, mate, sad. We know you're up a fucking...
Some people want to help people, some people want to help themselves, don't they?
Yes, yeah, I just fucking...
And if they're helping themselves, yeah.
So, that's what I mean. It's just like, each to their own, really. I'm not going to fucking go on their page giving them shit. You know, they probably go on my page giving me shit, but they're allowed to do that. But it's just each flavour to their own and that. But this social media sort of become a thing where everyone's got a voice, good or bad, and it's just building it. Yeah, your information comes from social media. You buy your things from social media. Now, you know, if you're on Instagram, you go on these closed pages, or you can even go on like Dolce & Gabbana and stuff like that. Go the link, you buy.
Yeah.
So everything now is all my businesses are all social media based. Watch changing, brand, man. Raw Dog, you know, stuff like that. It's all social media.
Tell us about Raw Dog. Yeah.
The bit of the backstory, obviously, you know, I've got a little bit of beef going with Platinum Mike Perry. So in the first lockdown, I remember messaging him. I said, listen, me and you are going to fight one day, Perry. Let's just have some beef. Because I put a post and he messaged me like, what the fuck, man? Like, I'll slap your ass when I see you. And I was like, no, you won't. And I said, come on, let's just have some beef. Say something back. I started saying stuff back and we were putting posts about each other and that. And then one day I just put this post. I was like, lad, don't get it twisted, mate. I'll fucking spin your jaw and Raw Dog your beard every day. And he just got with this new beard. Yeah, this Latoria or something. And he was, you know, good looking girl. And you know when you find like true love and that, I think it must have like
got
him. Next day I went on. I get reported a lot by Instagram. The close to shutting my account down 100%. And I got this reported page and I was like, what the fuck? And he blocked me. And I thought, the little muppet, is he taking that serious? Yeah. So I sat there and I thought, nah, we're mates. Like, and he took it serious. He went to Twitter and said, this till is a fucking piece of shit. And I thought, okay, yeah, really? So I just started, mate, just absolutely leathering him. And he just didn't have nothing for me. And then it went on for months. He was proper. He was going, he was saying, when I see Till, I'm going to break his teeth. I'm going to bite him and everything. And I people were saying to me, what's going to happen if you see Perry? I said, lad, I'll absolutely spin him all over. There won't be none of that. So, you know, but obviously I didn't take it serious either. I just laughed.
I'm not asked
in the slightest. So, the guy who works for me does all my like my stuff. He's got me Dad Until official store, which isn't online right now. We're waiting. It's in process. He come to me and he was like, Darren, you need to do a Raw Dog like thing. And I was like, what do you mean? He was like, Raw Dog? I was like, do you know how many messages you're getting? Because sometimes he does the message. Oh, he was like, Darren, do it. I said, okay, we'll make a plan. I said, I don't want to be one of these guys just bringing a t-shirt out. And there's the t-shirt. Go and buy it online. I said, I want to do something really big on social media. I do consider myself quite, good on social media. I said, yeah. So I said, what we'll do is, right, I said, we're going to bring drops out. He said, what do you mean? I said, we're going to drop a t-shirt, but it's only going to be there for a limited amount of time. I said, then we're going to drop something else and drop something else. And he went, okay, that might work. Work, mate. I remember the first fucking t-shirt we done last year, just after my fight with Whittaker. So I said, right, Raw Dog's out there now. It looked like the Supreme badge and everything. They set the business up and I said, it's here for 7 days, go and get it. Mate, the website crashed 50 times. Just completely went mental. And he was like, see, I told you. I said, yeah, but the key to this is limited edition. Because if it's there forever, I can get that whenever. You know, like a nice t-shirt, you can get that whenever. Yeah. This needs to be limited edition. So then I brought a great t-shirt out. Same thing, I brought a lighter out. But I said to him, every time we bring a drop out, we're going to do a promo video. So we'll do a promo for every one of them. Gloves, jumper, we done a hat, two t-shirts, and then a brewery came to me. I was like, you need to do Raw Dog here. And I was like, why do we? Like, because it just goes hand in hand. You're on the ale, you're trying to shag beard. I'm not like, I've got a beard, you know. So I was like, okay. So I spoke to the guys who were obviously in with Raw Dog. I said, what do you think of this idea? I said, but this ain't going to be a drop. I said, the idea I've got of this now, I said, I want this to be in every bar, club, off license, anywhere. So I had the meeting and that, and we done it. We brought it out, Raw Dog. Yeah. At the start, we made a little thing with the price. The pricing was a bit high because it's craft beer. Craft beer is like a high percentage beer. So we changed the price and everything. You know, we done good sales. And the first place that come to see me overselling it was Gino's in Liverpool. Because I go there every day when it was open. And they're like, Adam, we want to get it on a beer tap. I'm like, okay? So after that, Duke Street Market, a place in the Baltic Market, off licenses, Santa Maloco, where I used to own.
So it's out there on draft now?
Not now.
Oh.
This lockdown.
Yeah, yeah. You know, what do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Coming out on beer tap draft, cans, blah, blah, blah. I want to be getting a ship to America soon as Dubai, Brazil.
Wow.
That's just a brand made out of.
You know, that fellow owns that Road Dog. Used to be a fighter, you know.
Yeah.
Super bit of the
yeah, yeah. I'll be in the pub saying, that used to be me, that, you know.
Selwyn. So how are you juggling all this, that, with your real profession? You know, to say, keep the main thing is to keep the main thing, the
I
main thing.
I don't have nothing to do with it, Jazz. I just let the lads crack on, the lads who work. They just, they'll come to me and say, Darren, put a post out for us. So I always put a post out, descriptive, trying to have a laugh at it. Darren, what do you think of this? Yes, Sam, whatever. But in hindsight, I don't really have much to do with it. Same with the watchers, the guy who my business partner, just crack on, mate. I don't let anyone get him. Yeah. You know, when we try and set this podcast up, I was like, got an hour for you, boys.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Weekends are better. Weekend, I just sit there eating shite and just fucking watch telly. But through the week, mate, I've got a fucking split little bit of time in the afternoon, but I train morning and night, and I don't like to wake up early, so you aren't going to catch me in the morning. I know you like to wake up at 4s and 3s o'clock. Oh, imagine him saying to me, Dan, if you're going to run at 6, I'm like, all right, Jazz, I'm going to be there. Some people it works, doesn't. My training begins at 10:30, 11. So I don't need to wake up early, because if my runs get done, Colin makes me run every day.
Yeah.
So, you know.
So what's your typical day then, Dan?
I wake up. I've got a chef living with me at the moment, you know.
Boss in
the UFC in it,
is it open?
Like now, I'm here with you. As soon as I leave, he's gonna have me food cooked. So when I get home, I got to meet him, right? There's this guy, I don't know if you ever heard the guy, do you know George Lockhart?
Yeah, I've seen
Lockhart. He's working with Tyson Fury now, and he works with Conor McGregor. So he does these like classes. He'll teach people, you know, about nutrition and chefs and all that palaver. And this guy, Chefsky, who's with me, learned under George Lockhart, and how he got in touch with us was, I met him in Vegas and he got a photo with me and that, and he was on me quite heavily. He was like, mate, let me be your chef. And I was like, no, lad, fuck off. He's like, lad, let me be your chef. I was like, lad, I've got a photo with you, yeah. Get away. He's like, lad, he's quite cool, to be honest. He was quite persistent, but he was cool with it. I liked him, but I was proper nasty to him at first. I'm like, go away. He's like, all right, I'll email your coach. I was like, go ahead then.
Really haven't taken note.
I don't take no shit, I'm straightforward, mate. I say what's on my mind, you know what, it doesn't do anything all the time.
That's funny,
so he emailed me coach, and my coach Colin, you know, I won't answer him back ever. He said, yeah, we're going to get this guy in for your chef. And I went, don't tell me his name's Owen. He went, yeah, it's that little cunt's actually got that one, Colin. Little shit. So we met him in Vegas and that, mate, and honest to God, the food, the presentation, the flavours he puts in his food, he is a mastermind. His food is excellent. It doesn't feel like I'm dieting. Obviously, I've moved up a weight class now from middleweight, yeah. So I can be a bit more, you know, relaxed. You know, over weekend I can have a little something to eat, but over week it doesn't, you know, massive cooked meals. If I'm hungry overnight, he'll cook me. He's just there in the kitchen now.
Is he calculating your macros for you every day?
Yeah, so he just weighs me. He's just doing the macros. He'll give me a bit extra of this, bit extra of that. But we're like 11 weeks, 10 weeks out now, so obviously it's more easy. My weight will drop, fly off, but it's just easy coming home. Your food's there. Blah, 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 blah. To bed. Your food's there. My protein shakes are there. Everything's there. Unbelievable. I couldn't. Like, it's just changed. Yeah. When I didn't have him, mate, I was come home. I'm hungry. I'll just fucking go to the fridge and grab something.
Yeah. I work with Carl Evans and I found that handing that responsibility over him.
I think I know.
Carl Evans,
yeah.
Sports, did, yeah. John Moores University. Handing the responsibility over making the weight, it's on him.
Yeah.
So I can just not worry about it, because I feel like, do you feel like you're holding on to the weight when you're worrying? I feel like I can't let go.
I'm going to be honest, mate.
You don't look like you're worried, Dan.
No, John, I'm going to like just put it out there now. Jazzy, you're a lot more dedicated with the weight than I am. You wake up at 6 and run hills and you're on your diet yourself, pal. I don't wake up at 6 and run hills and I eat 5 guys as a diet. Let's just get that out there now. Jazza Dickens is so much more dedicated. I watched some of your YouTube things, you know, and I remember sitting there and I said, Spin, have you seen this dickhead, Jazza? She's like, what? I said, he's getting up at 6, what are you doing? And she's like, are you secretly jealous? I was like, yeah, I'd love to. And I remember I said to her, I said, you know what? fucking look at the dedicated lad. Dedication is so much more than man when it comes to food, mate. Because honestly, I am like that. Just I'll get out the gym, I'm hungry, I'll just grab something. I don't think I'll just grab. I'd rather suffer at the end. But I have matured. And, like when I was at welterweight, mate, it was fucking disgusting. Just I was cutting 30 kilos, 40 kilos. It was. See the size of me? I'm 6'2", mate. I'm a big lad to get to 77 kilos.
Wow, no, 30 kilos. In how long?
Sorry?
In how long are you cutting 30 kilos?
Like, I remember some nights before the weigh-ins, I'd be cutting 9 kilos.
Fuck.
Like, I'm a serious heavyweight cutter. Like, you've seen the Wonder... I don't know if you've
seen the documentary.
Wow, yeah.
Went blind and that, you know what I mean? But at middleweight now, Jazz, I've gone up 7 kilos. I've walked around about 91, 92. Perfect for the weight, you know, cutting it gradually. I've matured, as we all do in every way, shape, or form in life. You mature. No matter what you do, you mature, don't you? You know, and that's one thing I remember saying to Colin. I said, I'm going to get Chef over. I was like, I'm going to see how much he wants monthly. I'm going to see what we can work out. He can live with me in that accommodation and I want him over. But even after this fight now, I want him here. I want to stay on it. Obviously, I want to drift off a bit, but I want to stay on 3 meals a day, good, clean, cooked food. I've never done well with the meal preps, to be honest, Jazz, because I don't like the thought of like coming home and your food and you've got to warm up out the tray after 2 days. I come home and it's freshly cooked, roast or not. That for me, just gives me a little bit of, you know what I mean? People are different. As I say, Jazz, it's Ian Army, you're more dedicated than me. And that's it.
I don't like the meal preps. I just fucking eat them cold and just look like a caveman.
You just get on with it, lad.
Jazz is a fucking beast. Well, did I see that? Did you say someone you were fighting? Did you see you were getting up at 6 o'clock to fight? And you found out they're getting up at 5, so you started getting up at 4. Yeah. Is that right?
Did you see that? Fully well imagined, Jazz.
Is that what you've done?
Yeah.
Go ahead, tell me.
Go ahead. There's some woman on Facebook anyway. I've just done my 6 a.m. run. I thought,
was her name Karen Till?
I fucked away one time that, and I watched your video on YouTube to make myself feel better about making the weight because I knew it's not going to be that hard. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Have you seen the documentary?
No, I haven't.
Yeah. It's on YouTube, John.
Was this in America? This?
No, it was in Liverpool. It was the Echo Arena fight. It actually wasn't meant to come out at the time. I was sponsored by Paddy Power, you know, the betting thing. They sponsored me, and at the time I was sponsored by Gymshark as well. And Paddy Power acquired the video somehow. Someone. Put it out there
before the fight,
before the weigh-in. They put it out there, and it went fucking completely mental. And a lot of people were like, "This is bad." Like what he's gone through. Watch it, John. It's about 30-40 minutes long.
Is it? Yeah.
You lost your.
It'll open your eyes to like serious heavyweight cut and why we shouldn't do it. But it got put out there. And if you ever do want to feel better, mate, fucking watch that. Because honestly, you see me. I'm just
really
that completely.
When you got dry mouth, it's like your whole body is dry mouth. It's just fucking horrible, isn't it?
Oh, it is, yeah.
In the future, though, moving forward, what's the plan for you?
You know what, Jazz? You know, I just want to be the best, mate. Yeah. I've said this since like 12. That's the only thing I can say. I don't want to say anything else. I just want to be the best fighter in what I do. I just want to be the best. I want people to say Till was one of the best. I want people to say Till was number one for all time, ever and ever. Till was one of the best. I'll sit back and I'll be happy, mate.
Drop the belt in your house and
the belt and greatness, though. I'm chasing greatness. The belt is great, but after that, I want to chase greatness with it. You know what I mean? Obviously, money fights and all that stuff, yeah. It's very fucking, you know, we all love money, but I just want to chase greatness first. I think the era we're in now, of like, as I said to you, social media. You can make money easily with like all your sponsorships and, as you say, little side businesses and be clever and invest wisely. But greatness is sort of my finger, my man, every single day.
And wait, if you chase, well, not chase the greatness, but if that's your goal, everything else is just going to come anyway, you
know? No, do you know what, John? After that, I think I could probably like sit back and be very content with my life.
That's what I mean. If you've just got that goal, everything else is just going to come anyway.
Yeah. I think
rather focused on money or this or that,
I said, on the side, you know, like I could have a few years back when I was in Brazil, I could have just went and got a job and said, oh, I'll leave the fighting for now. You know, as long as I can get that little fucking thing of greatness, everything else for me is fucking, I don't give a fuck.
Money can come and go, can't
it? Yeah. Anything can come and go, but that greatness, mate, is only here now. It's not going to be here in 10, 20 years, do you know what I mean?
Mm. Well, Darren Till. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Really appreciate it.
Say how are we again?
You know what I'm talking
about? I knew it was good.
Yeah, look away, Dan.
Gonna go to Catholic and say, fair laughing. Gonna go to Catholic and laugh.
How are we? Welcome back to the How Are We Famalong podcast with me, Shaky Cheat, and my mate Jazza. Traffing along. I know Dallin, yeah. Me and Dallin go back time, yeah, because I used to get the bus with him to the gym, and I didn't. We used to get two buses, lad, didn't we, lad?
Glad, yeah.
County Road, lad, he was skint, lad. Didn't have a pot of piss and ice, but have to pay for him, lad. Now he won't even give me a can of raw dog, lad. Anyway, there we was, yeah, going to this gym. Remember, lad?
Yeah, I remember, yeah.
Must have got him in this hour bar, lad. Funny, lad. Ha! Anyway, thanks for tuning in for the How Are We Family Lamb podcast. In a bit, get on chill, eh, lad. Lad, you used to come into our house, like, you used to have candlesticks wrapped around his nose, lad, all the snot, lad. You might have to wipe his nose, no, lad. It's right, lad. Ta-da.
Next time on the How Are We Family Lamb podcast, we'll be speaking to Billy Clements.
So is your childhood stolen from you in a way, if you're doing what you were doing? Can you have a childhood in the street with your mates?
Yeah. Because you were famous? Was it different for you?
No, I didn't allow it to be. Still hung around with my mates on the streets and everything. Yeah. Yeah.
What do you mean? He used to do that, didn't he?
Yeah.
He used to like go and play for him and then go and play like headers and volleys with his mates and crocky.
So it was like we all hanging around with Billy. Everyone say we all hanging around with Billy.
Yeah.
Yeah, like 1 minute I'm on... Do you know what? I won a soap award as well. So 1 minute win a
soap
award.
You won a soap award?
Next minute I'm standing outside the office asking someone to get away from me for a bottle of Lamborghini.
Faster Car Finance provide a smooth, hassle-free way for you to apply for car finance and to get the vehicle of your choice. Whether you have good or bad credit, no deposit is required. A decision is reached within minutes and one of our dedicated finance advisors will be available to discuss your requirements. Apply now at www.fastercarfinance.co.uk.